Hi there.
Hello.
Good morning, Taylor.
Hello, Paulo, Amy. Hello. Nice to see you.
Hey, kids. Very nice to see you again.
Here as well. Okay, Paulo, I guess you can start.
Terrific. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. I have not met everybody, so let me introduce myself. I'm Paulo Carazza, the director of the Kellogg Institute for International Studies. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you all here this morning, a little bit later this morning for you in Brazil. But at the Kellogg Institute, we're really very pleased and privileged to host this, for the important substance of the conversation, but this transcontinental dialogue is wonderful. As well, and I think both you and Erica, and you and seeing it through, shepherding it both conceptually and organizationally, because I'm sure it's going to be a very fruitful day for all of the participants. I'm sorry that I won't be here myself for the day. I have to teach. Unfortunately, our students do still come, notwithstanding all my efforts to drive them away. And so I'm going to leave you now to go to my class, but I look forward to hearing about how the conversation went and the dialogue. And again, thank you.
É porque é uma conferência. Não, agora está falando lá dos Estados Unidos.
Conceived of this because we were two Brazilianists working on public opinion in Brazil who happened to be in residence here at the same time last semester. So this is a product of the Kellogg Institute, and it would not have existed if it weren't for the sponsorship of the Kellogg Institute. The Kellogg Institute has been fantastically accommodating every step of the way in helping us bring this idea to reality. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Amy, Erica. We do above all want to be really a community of people and a place where we bring people together around these important ideas. So this is a great example of that. So all the best in the course of the day.
Hello, and Amy. Thank you. Amy, Rodrigo Gonzalez would like to welcome you. He's the vice director of our graduate program in political science. And he'd like to give them a welcome word.
Good morning, everyone here and everyone in the United States. I wish to welcome participants and wish a hard work in the name of the graduate program of political science at UFRGS. And I like to congratulate Professor Castro and Professor Amy Smith for this organization. And I'd like to thank all the students, all the people that worked hard for this seminar to happen. Thank you and good work.
Thank you, Rodrigo. Amy, I have nothing to say, but thank you. Thank you to my students. Thank you to my colleagues at the Graduate Program of Political Science, especially the political culture students at our university who are so responsive to this call and were, fundamental part of making this happen. And to you, Amy, for doing the best in order to organize that. And tell the people at Kellogg that I miss you so much. And well, I think we can begin, America. And I think Giovanni, you can, and Giovanni, we organize from our side the first section. I don't know how to organize it, America, because you haven't discussed it yet, but I think that you can begin immediately with the first section, isn't it? Is okay for you?
especially to the many people working behind the scenes who have made this happen. Teresa, Sharon, Elizabeth, Karen have just been tremendously helpful in making this happen. Thanks to all of you for coming from across the United States and from your home in Boston to the conference, and to all of you in Brazil for being here with us today. One other thing that Henrique and I had said that we were going to say in our preliminary remarks was that we also think the Latin American Studies Association's journal, the Latin American Research Review, the Professor Aníbal Pérez Liñán, who's the editor of the journal, has promoting this conference, and is listed as a sponsor of the conference in potentially publishing a dossier of articles coming out of this conference on public opinion, current issues in public opinion in Brazil. So there will be a potential publication opportunity, and Henrique and I decided that we were going to announce the deadlines, those kinds of things, probably in an email next week to all of you guys. Okay. With no further ado, yes, let's get started. Giovanni and Juan.
Thank you very much, Amy. Before we start, I would like to give the general outline of the upcoming work discussion sessions. In each session, there will be one work to be presented here and discussed from the United States, and one work to be presented in the United States and discussed from here. So after we are done with the paper discussion, we are going to open for questions. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, we can only have two questions from each side. So choose wisely and try to keep them short. I would like to invite our presenter and discussant for this session to come to the desk, please. I will. Fabrício. Okay, so I would like to present, to introduce our presenter, Renata Andrade de Oliveira is a PhD student in political sociology at the Federal University of Santa Catarina. She has a master's degree in social sciences from the State University of Maringá, and she's dedicated to studies on democracy, gender, and representation. And the discussant from our side is Dr. Fabrício Pontin. He is a PhD in philosophy from the Southern Illinois University. He's currently a postdoctoral researcher at the philosophy graduate program at the Pontifical Catholic University of Rio Grande do Sul. Dr. Fabrício studies democratic theory, distributive justice, equity, and federalism. He is also a member of the Brazilian Center for Research on Democracy, of the work group Theory of Justice, and of the Center for Marxist Studies. So, please, if you could start, Renata.
Thank you. So, good morning, everybody. My name is Renata. Like I said, I'm a PhD student in okay, it's better now?
Yes.
Okay, so good morning. My name is Renata. I wrote this article with my supervisor, Julian Borba. Unfortunately, he couldn't came, so he sent his apology, but we want to say thank you for the opportunity to be here today and share this work with you. So the title is Woman in Politics, a comparison between public opinion and an evidence from a least experimental. So the general theme is related with my PhD thesis. It's about the gap between So the general theme of my thesis is the gap between the women and men parliamentary representation in Latin America. But specifically in this article, we work with the rejection of the Brazilians with the woman in political office. So like we said, we are in 2007 and Brazil still have under 10% of women in parliamentary. So this is a real problem. I think, okay. So the questions we want to touch in this article is about the aspect of this rejection. So it's a little bit different from the majority of the works that study the underrepresentation of women. So now we want to know about what are the aspects of this rejection. So what the public opinion say for us, and what at least experiment can say for us for we about that. So if this research, they are in the same path, or the research shows different thing for us. So in the January, what we can indicate about the studies of the future studies about under woman underrepresentation. So our first step, so this work is our first step about that, the work with the rejection. And our theoretical start is with the a part of the feminist theory and the future studies. There are quotes that say the values that for the impact of the underrepresentation. So this is the line we want to work here in this article, and our variables are choice by that. So we use the WVS surveys and LAPOP and a list experiment that we did. So in the first graphs, so first thing we said we use was because we want to know the reject, we use the just the response in the questions about the agreement with some kind of behaviors that the behaviors that not are less favored to the equality between the gender and the politics. So we make here a comparison between the other dimensions. Okay, so we make some kind of comparison between other dimensions about gender equality, like jobs and education. And we see that in politics is the most have the high levels across the time and is more constant. So we have about the mean in all the time is 25% the Brazilians that still reject the woman in fear. So they say they agree the men are better political leaders than the woman. So what do we make here? We go to the multivariable analysis with our dependent. So we go to the multivariable analysis with our dependent variable was the agreement with men are better leader, political leaders than women. So we choose here just demographic aspects, questions about politics, and here questions about gender equality in different dimensions. So what do we see here? We use these two models that have two variables that are constant, where the position about women and jobs and sex. And why do we see that the questions about politics don't have statistical mean, statistical significance, and the other question, the other variable that have significance was about the woman and education. So in general, what we can say that aspects that more important here are sex and the other behaviors that Brazilians have about other types of gender equality. So in the general is that the individuals who have position less favored to gender equality in politics are the men and who are less favored to the equality in other dimensions of social life. So after that, we started to talking about could this level of agreement be bigger? So could the people are truly saying that he's agree or not with women in politics? So we could be possible to make a list experimental. So we did a list experiment in the project Democracy, Media, and Social Capital. They're coordinated by the NUPSAL, Center of Research about Latin America, here at the University of Rio Grande do Sul. So thank you for who make this project possible. But how we participated only in Florianopolis in 2006, so the LIST experiments was just possible here in that city, and was with high school students. use like to base studies the Strebenow 2008 experimental. Our design was that for the control group, we have this question and we make a list of some statement and ask it how many of these statements they disagree. And for the test group, our second group that received the treatment, we ask about a third statement that's our treatment, a woman occupying a public office. So we can pass. So in January, the group were balanced and we just showing here our preliminary tests and results. And they showed that about 25% of the high school students disagree with women have a political office. So like this experimental was realized in 2006, we still study and develop the test with this experimental. So the other test, now they didn't show a result for other type of variable could have an impact in this percentage. So, like this, after the time is short, I'm going to conclude. So in January, what the public opinion say to us? They say that a portion, we have a majority of the Brazilians still disagree with gender inequality in political office, but have a portion that is still rejects. But this portion is constant and across the time. When we see other types about other variables about gender equality, we see the importance of the impact of the division of the public sphere and the private sphere. It's like they say they reinforce the political stereotype about men and women in politics. That's why, because they answer that for the woman is more emotional, the man is more rational, and the woman is make better educational policies, and the men make better politics like economic politics and all these things, policies and this thing. So this reinforces the stereotype about men and women in politics. So the other thing we want to stand out is the importance of the attitude about gender in other dimensions like jobs and education. So the list experiment, what he showed for us, that hypothesis that the younger people could be more egalitarian could be questionable. So this is something that we want to investigate. And the percentage of the experimental and the public opinion polls are very similar, 25% and 29%, and it's still similar with the others find of Strab article. There was 26% of the American reject a woman in public offices too. So what this in the whole we can say that we cannot confirm that the public opinion have a social desirable effect. But we can say that it have a very important portion of the population that still disagree with former participating in public office. So this could be significant for the resistance for the woman entry in public office and have more representation in the parliamentary. So thank you very much.
Hi, Giovanni. This is Juan, your American counterpart. So our original discussant couldn't come because of health issues. Oh, are we drinking coffee first or then the discussant? Okay. So, hello? There he is. So, can they use this? No, he's a presenter.
Okay.
Can they hear me?
Yeah, they can hear.
So if they're having a problem, there were too many feeds, so they have to like turn off this. So we might want to turn off our feeds or something like that.
Okay.
To accommodate.
We only have one.
But the discussant is coming in.
No, the discussant is one.
Oh.
The discussant is one, but first the other is
present. So he's presenting first, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So hi, Giovanni. I'm going to introduce our American presenter. He is not here physically, so he's also through video conference. Taylor Boas, who is going to present the paper Norms versus Action, Voting Against Malfeasance in Brazil, along with Dani Hidalgo and Mariana Batista. He is assistant professor of political science and Latin American studies at Boston University, and also a former visiting fellow of the Kellogg Institute at Notre Dame, so de la casa. He has a great number of publications in the top journals of our discipline, and most recently he published his book, Presidential Campaigns in Latin America, Electoral Strategies and Success Contagion by Cambridge University Press. So Taylor, thanks for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear and see me okay?
We can hear you.
Okay. All right, well, I will then proceed to present, and my understanding is that someone there will be advancing my slides. There they are, wonderful. Thank you very much. I apologize for the fact that I'm presenting remotely, as Juan said. Mariana Batista, who is a participant on the project, although not a co-author in this particular paper, was going to present and then had some last minute health issues, but I'm pleased to be with you remotely. So advance to the next slide, please. So the question that we're addressing in this project is whether voters punish corrupt or malfeasant politicians at the polls. And there's been a lot of work that's been done on this using a variety of different types of data, but most recently we've seen a surge of vignette experiments. These are survey experiments that pose a hypothetical scenario to voters. And you can see here the text from one of the most recent ones to be published on Brazil by White, Shapiro, and Winters. And so in brief, the treatment group gets the text in red, in addition to the text in black. The control group gets only the text in black. And these studies in Brazil and elsewhere have almost always shown a significant effect of information about corruption or malfeasance on intended vote. So next slide, please. So right here I'm plotting, I put a number of studies of different countries that are comparable in terms of the research design, put all the effects on the same scale, and you can see that in most instances, at least some sort of information about corruption has a negative significant effect on intended vote. And you'll notice that these studies that have been done in Brazil really stand out in terms of the magnitude of effects. Next slide, please. Okay, so these vignette experiments suggest that the answer to this question is yes, but this literature also acknowledges that in the real world, effects should probably be smaller than they are in these hypothetical situations. There's a variety of reasons for this, just to touch a couple. The information might not be credible in the real world. It might be presented by an opposition party rather than some sort of independent source. Another example is the fact that in the real world, the target of this accusation has the chance to respond in the context of the campaign and maybe even launch a counter accusation. And so, you know, there's a variety of reasons why we might expect these real world effects to be smaller. And so in this project, we're looking to test the effect on real voting behavior. And Brazil is a logical place to do that, given that the effects that we found in these vignette experiments are so large in comparison to some other countries. Next slide, please. So I want to underscore, first of all, that there is a strong anti-corruption norm in Brazil, which is what we think underlies the large significant effects that we find in these vignette experiments. So here we see data from the America's Barometer surveys from 2004 to the present. This is the open-ended question on the most important problem in the country. Brazil has the highest sustained levels of concern with corruption measured by this question. Move to the next slide, please. If we look at the World Values Survey, particularly recently, Brazil is very strong in terms of opposition to bribery. So the percentage who say that accepting a bribe is never justifiable in the most recent wave, which was fielded in Brazil in 2014, Brazil ranked 8th out of about 60 countries on that percentage. Next slide, please. So to test these effects in a real world context, we conducted a field experiment in the state of Pernambuco. This was surrounding the recent municipal elections in October 2016. And we did this in partnership with the State Accounts Court of Pernambuco, the Tribunal de Contas, which is an agency that audits municipal governments. The treatment information was delivered via a flyer and also in the context of a baseline survey. So it was summarized orally as well. And it informed voters as to whether their mayor's accounts had been accepted or rejected by the court. There were half of the respondents fell into each category, mayor's accounts accepted or rejected. The main outcome we're looking at is self-reported vote, which we measure in a second post-electoral wave of the survey. And then finally, we also conducted a vignette experiment, basically taking the text from White, Shapiro, and Winters, but substituting in our specific treatment information so that we could compare the real-world effect of this information to the vignette experiment effect. Next slide, please. So this is an example of one of our flyers. This is informing voters in the municipality of Abreu y Lima that the mayor's accounts were approved. Right, so you can see on the right-hand side of the screen, this is the municipality's specific information. We tell them that 88% of municipios in the state had the mayor's accounts approved, 12% were rejected. If this were a municipality where the accounts were rejected, then the information would be slightly different on that backside. Next slide, please. To measure vote, we use a secret ballot to get around social desirability, bias, and demand effects. And so voters were given a municipality-specific ballot that looked like this and asked to privately mark off their vote choice after the election and then drop it in a sealed ballot box. Next slide, please. What do we find in terms of effects? So this is one of those cases where we have a null effect and we're hoping we have an interesting way of framing it and publishing it. So we find that there are no significant effects of this information either on evaluation of the mayor's job performance in general, evaluation of his performance specifically with respect to municipal accounts, or on the decision to vote for the incumbent mayor's reelection. And this is true both of positive information about accounts being approved and also negative information about them being rejected. Next slide, please. But when we present the same information in the context of a vignette experiment, we essentially replicate Winters and White Shapiro's results, right? So the dark circles are theirs, the unfilled ones are ours, and we find no significant difference between the point estimates that we obtain and that they obtain. Next slide. So the question is, why do norms and action diverge? We're arguing that this behavior in the abstract is driven by the norm against corruption, but that we don't see voters acting on that when they go to the polls. And I'll highlight quickly two reasons that we think are important. First of all, the salience of more tangible issues when voters go to cast a ballot. And then secondly, attitudes for or against local political dynasties. Next slide, please. So we asked voters in the first round what they thought was the biggest problem in the municipality. And in the second round, we asked them what the biggest issue in the campaign was that the candidates were talking about. And you can see, you know, health tops the list, crime, jobs, the drought, which is a major issue in the Sertão, sanitation, schools. All of these are important issues for voters and for candidates. Corruption and accounts were spontaneously mentioned hardly at all, right? So this is not a major issue on people's mind or on candidates' mind. Next slide, please. And another thing that we found, and this draws from some qualitative research, case studies that we had done on a number of the municipalities and some focus groups, is that while we all know that mass partisanship is low in Brazil, there are political dynasties that dominate politics in many of these towns. And attitudes toward these political dynasties serve a similar purpose as partisanship in democracies where rates of party identification are higher. So just to identify these examples here, we've got a campaign poster from the Municipio Primavera. The candidate is the woman. The guy on the left is not her vice mayoral running mate. It's her son, who was mayor previously, right? And this kind of thing is not uncommon in campaign advertising. And there were a number of candidates who were from political dynasties. You can see on the right, a campaign flyer for another candidate highlighting mayors and his family going back to the 1920s. And a quote from one of our focus groups. We had a number of these quotes in which people were really highlighting their loyalty to particular local political groups in a very similar way that we think of people talking about partisan identification in advanced democracies. Next slide, please. So, you know, we conclude from this study that in the abstract, voters are very happy to punish Mayor Carlos in a municipio like your own, right? And this is driven by this anti-corruption norm, but when they go to act in real life, there are a number of other factors that inhibit action based on that norm. And we've highlighted trade-offs with more tangible performance criteria and their attitudes toward local political dynasties. Thanks very much.
So Giovanni, should I start with the discussion of the Brazilian paper and then we will allow for the discussion on the Brazilian side?
Yeah, I think that will be best.
Okay, perfect. So our original discussant couldn't comment on the paper, and I think she sent the presenters some of her comments written down, but Amy asked me if I could jump in, and so I'm the substitute discussant. Please, everything I say with a grain of salt. So Renata and Julian's paper is interesting, and it sets out to explore the potential for social desirability bias when asking survey respondents about positions regarding gender equality. And as they state, the central question, and I'm translating here loosely what they say in their paper, is if the results of the experiment and public opinion surveys are similar or contradict each other, indicating potential desirability bias with regards to gender equality, gender political equality. And as Renata mentioned, they don't find a substantial difference between what LAPOP and World Vitality surveys report as gender misogyny and what they find in their treated group of high school students in Florianopolis. So we don't see a big difference between the survey, well, the list experiment and survey data, which is in itself really interesting. However, and this is really interesting, I think towards the end of the paper, the authors actually point out to one of the central findings of the paper itself, and I think probably one of the most interesting findings, which is that they actually do find a treatment effect between their treated and control groups in their list experiment. And this effect refers to young people. So young people do seem to have a very strong social desirability bias, or at least the people that participated in the list experiment in Florianopolis. So they raise an interesting question as well. This kind of suggests that young people are not as progressive as one would think. So given this finding, here are some of my suggestions and comments. First, I would suggest reformulating the paper a little bit and centering around this finding in particular, which is in my opinion, one of the most interesting ones, and give the reader from the beginning an idea that this is going to be central, the idea of youth and social desirability bias with regards to gender equality. I think that is probably one of the most central parts of the paper, and it only comes towards the end of the discussion, and there is the theoretical discussion, which is about the importance of cultural values and political gender equality, is kind of disconnected somewhat from this finding. And in particular, I mean, it's interesting, why would young people exhibit this kind of extreme desirability bias? Is it because the environment they're in, so they're more exposed to trying to falsify their actual true preferences about gender equality? What is going on? Why, I would really much like some theoretical or even some speculation as to why do we see this kind of strong social desirability bias with young high school students in Florianopolis. And second, and this is related, towards the end the paper states that there should be the expectation that young people are more progressive, at least with regards to gender equality. And while that does seem intuitive, I think this is an expectation they have to develop further. Why should we expect this? And when I think about this, I remember some studies on young people in the US and cohorts with opinions about abortion. And they actually, some of them show that the younger generations are even more pro-life than older cohorts. So expecting younger people to be more progressive, while it seems intuitive, it's not necessarily so. And I think that's something that you find. So I think this is something that you would want to develop further. And particularly because if we look at your regression analysis, you do tell us that age does not have a significant effect on predicting attitudes towards gender political equality. So your regression analysis itself is telling us, well, young people shouldn't be more progressive. So I would weed this in and put this into your analysis. And finally, just some brief comments. I would really want to know more about this young group of students in Florianópolis. So what, in particular, because I'm interested in like at least having an idea of, is this particular to these students in the city, in this area? Should we be expecting something similar if we conducted this experiment elsewhere in Brazil, in another city, in another region? So what can we learn about this experiment that potentially could indicate other trends in Brazil? So it was a really interesting paper, an interesting read, and those are my few comments, but I'm sure the other discussant also gave them more thorough comments. Thanks, Giovanni.
Thank you very much, Juan, for stepping in, and I would like to pass the word to Dr. Fabrício so he can discuss the other paper.
Of course. Thanks a lot for the invitation. I'm a bit of an alien here, as my original field is actually philosophy, political philosophy to be more clear, and formal theory. But I also have a kind of a thing for voting analysis. So I read your paper with great, great pleasure, Professor Boas, and I couldn't take, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, great. So I think I have some ideas here that might be interesting. One of the things that caught my attention is that, of course, you have a question about whether or not people perceive bribery to be wrong, and they often do, right? But one of the things that I kept on thinking about is that, what if we added another question on whether or not the gentleman or the woman, the lady answering the question had ever accepted bribery, or if one would ever accept bribery. And I think that would be an interesting variable, because considering the way in which bribery and corruption is widespread in everyday life in Brazil, I think most participants would actually answer that they have, or they would. And some, at least they could reckon themselves being in a situation in which they would have to accept, or they would just, you know, be inserted in a situation in which corruption would just be normalized. And I think you bring a very interesting point about the way in which, and that reminded me of Anthony Downs' axiom of voting, because the way in which individuals just value some priorities more than corruption. And I think that one of the reasons why individuals will tend to also just accept other priorities as more important in the moment of voting is that they just see each candidate canceling each other out in terms of corrupt activities. They just assume that the other candidate is also corrupt, or just as corrupt, if not more, and maybe I just don't know about it yet. So they will value other priorities instead. And I think that that's an important point here. And it's also of great consequence to the way in which we can interpret your figure, the figure 12, right? I think that the account of corruption, in a way, is acknowledged here in a very little, as not a big problem, because it's just assumed as part of something that is so widespread that you just admit that it's okay. Every single person that is going to be in this election is going to have corruption issues. It's just part of the field. Another thing that I kept on thinking is how big or how much the current operations, including the publicity of the Lava Jato operation, will impact the perception of corruption in future elections. I'm not sure I agree with the interpretation that the current election, and this is something that is towards the end of the paper, that Dumas was that the current municipal election was impacted by corruption itself. Myself, I would be more keen on interpreting it as differences on the alliances, as PMDB has left, in most of the cases, the support for the Labour Party. And I think that affected a great deal the chances of the Labour Party in the municipal field, because that was a trend already in 2012. In the election of 2012, single party candidates by PT, by the Labour Party, they often lost. So even though if you consider it in terms of the alliance with the federal government, they often won, because one way of, or another, some party in the alliance would have won. And that was still the case in terms of the federal government. Some party in the federal government won in 2016, and that party was often PMDB. And if corruption was indeed affecting the perception, then PMDB shouldn't have won, because it's the most affected within this corruption investigations, in fact. So there is something amiss here, in my opinion. Actually not amiss. It's actually quite coherent with figure 12, but it's not coherent with the interpretation in the end of the paper. I don't think we can say at all that corruption has impacted the municipal elections. If they had, people, I think that people wouldn't have voted. Well, they hadn't actually. The number of, and that's something that I didn't see in your paper, and I think it's relevant. The number of people that are just not voting anymore in Brazilian elections, it has been a PJ. It's really a geometric progression in number of people that are just giving up on voting on municipal and federal elections. And I think that's a very relevant thing towards the way in which we are going to interpret, for example, attitudes and just, you know, apathy towards voting in Brazil, meaning, you know, the game is rigged, it's all smokes and mirrors, and it really doesn't matter who's winning because they're all equally corrupt and all compromised with the same central, you know, voting kind of attitude. I think that André Singer has had some very important works on that, as well as Marcos Nobre, and I think both of them would help in this part of the analysis. But I really, really enjoyed reading your paper, and I apologize as an alien to the discussion here, but I also think that these are important issues, especially for the way in which the final conclusions have been interpreted in the paper. But thanks for the opportunity of reading.
Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Fabricio. Now we would open for questions. So I would like to know if anybody here in the audience would like to pose a question to either of the presenters. It looks like everybody's a little shy here. Oh, yes, we have one.
Good morning. Go ahead. I am Professor Rodrigo Gonzalez. In the issue of corruption, I don't know if maybe the results can be explained, because people think sometimes corruption not as a legal problem, but as a moral problem. So in the experiment, if the accountant's court approval or not is not a problem. The problem if is a scandal with this, if it's a moral issue, not a legal issue, to people think as corruption.
Thank you, Professor. We have a second question here.
My name is Jackson Aquino. I have two questions, two comments. To Taylor Boas, is that I think that when people in Brazil answer that our president is corrupt, it's more when they don't like the government, they don't like the performance of the government, they think the government is corrupt. If they like the performance, they think the government is not corrupt. In 2010, I asked this question about comparing Lula and FHC, Fernando Henrique Cardoso, and people that liked Lula said that FHC was corrupt. and people that like the FHC said that Lula was corrupted. So they did not think about the Mensalão scandal at the time. They think about the performance of the government. And for Patricia, for Renata, I have a suggestion that you could consider. You could build an index of sexism by adding the values of the four variables: equality of rights for men and women. Men have more rights to job than women. Men have more rights to higher education than women. And men are better politicians than women. Principal component analysis could be used to check whether the four variables are measuring different dimensions of the same concept or not. And if yes, then the regression model on table one could not include the attitudes to gender issues as independent variables. That is, it would be an endogenous model.
Thank you, Professor Jackson. So Juan, you have the word now.
Okay, so we have two questions here. Well, if someone has a question, but if you have a question, could you please use the mic, because if not, they won't hear. Or we can move it around. Okay. Hello? Oh, it is. Okay. I have two questions, one for each paper. David Samuels from Minnesota. For Renata, for both papers, actually, and I think this holds for all the papers here, especially in light of the possibility of publishing these papers. The papers should I think, be more conscious of the timing of the experiments, that is, or of the surveys. 2016 is a terrible time and a great time to ask about corruption for research design purposes. It's also either a great time or a terrible time to ask about gender in politics, because the president is a woman accused of corruption. All of these things are interacting, perhaps intersectional, as Gladys's paper is going to talk about. So for Renata, Dilma está na mira. Exactly at the moment when you're putting your experiment into the field. And so my question is, like Professor Gustavo's, Jackson's follows on that, is what is the impact of opinion about Dilma and or partisan or anti-partisan attitudes on attitudes about gender in politics? So the first factor is, generally, opinion about Dilma may be contaminating your results entirely, given the timing. Second, we know that pechistas have different opinions about gender and politics than nonpartisans, and other partisans may also have an impact. So in both the multivariate analysis of LAPOP, you should include opinion about Dilma, as well as partisan, and if you have it, anti-partisan attitudes. The same thing in the list experiment. You should control for opinion about Dilma and partisanship. Doing so might really change your results in a really informative way. So, and for Taylor, I think your question, timing, is also an issue. Should we expect popular anger about corruption to matter more now? It's really interesting that it appears to matter not at all when you ask about it, right? But there's another potential issue, and that is a potential selection effect. I wrote this teeny little paper with Carlos and Lucio a few years ago about reeleição do deputado federal. And we find that they're unlikely to run for re-election if they're accused of corruption. But controlling for that fact, that being accused of corruption has absolutely no effect on whether they are reelected or not, because the ones who are accused, many of them think they're not going to be able to raise enough money to win reelection. So does this hold for mayors too? In your research design, you excluded municipalities where the mayor could run for reelection but chose not to. And this is, I think, a potentially important counterfactual for you. There might be a different effect in these municipalities. If not, I think that would be really interesting for you, understanding that, of course, people couldn't vote for these people.
you still might find an interesting effect, and that might inform the hypotheses at the end that you're trying to develop about what is more important, whether it's dynasties or some other effect.
Thank you, David.
I have another question.
Hi, everyone. I'm Amy Erica Smith again. I've got two, I also have two questions, and I'm going to make them very quick because we have very little time. Hinata, on your paper, unless I missed something, I don't see where you're comparing that 29% number, that really interesting, the number that stands out, to the proportion of youth who reject women in public opinion data. Maybe it's there, but I didn't see it in the paper. So the proper comparison would, of course, be the public opinion data in this particular population, ideally in Florianópolis, but that's probably not likely. You probably don't have a large enough sample to do it within Florianópolis, but at least within this particular population, say high school students, something like those. I mean, people who are high school educated or better in this particular population, whether they held the same attitudes, and that's what you would compare the 29% to. Taylor, a sentence in the discussion of your results really struck me, which is that the accounts are often rejected for having too many people, too large a portion of the budget on the public payroll, which from many politicians' perspectives is not a bad thing. Politicians like to pay people on the public payroll for all kinds of reasons. I'm wondering, I think in general, in public opinion in Brazil, I have the impression that these accounts are taken as evidence of corruption, but there are all kinds of corruption. I mean, there's the corruption where you funnel money into your public bank or into your Swiss bank account, and then there's corruption where what might be officially labeled corruption, but it's, you know, where you end up with 60% of your municipal budget devoted to payroll. And I would imagine these are very different kinds of corruption. They have very different moral weight. And the latter form of corruption should be, as you noted, really a boon for many politicians to be paying lots of people.
Thank you.
So Renata will give her final remarks now, comment on the questions and on the discussion. Please, Renata.
Okay, thank you for all the questions. It was very interesting. I think everybody touched in specific issues about the article. So like I said, our article is our first step. So we're still investigating, and the LIST experiment is very new for us and the results are new. So we still are working with all the results of the LIST experimental. So we have a specific article about just for the experimental. So all the characteristics of the group and all other questions about in the survey was in the other paper. But here we just want to show what the LIST experiment could show us, just an evidence of everything. But I think it's necessary to reformulate the central point of this article and the importance of the future values here. In our model, we didn't put the variables about other behavior like democracy and all these things, but something that we are working is just an initial model. So about the hype, I really agree that it's necessary to develop that in the regression in the youngest, because we start from the other studies about the youngest people that say they could be more egalitarian and more democratic. But this regression don't show that because I think miss some variables here. But like I said, it's just an initial model. About Jackson's suggestion, yes, I think that could be an endogenous model, because I think the model needs to be refined here. We just, sorry. Okay. So I think this dimension, they are correlated, and I think we have to work more and refine this model. But like I said, it's just an initial something that we can show. David, I totally agree with you. But then what happened is that the experiment was just made in Florianópolis and the survey was ready for us. We just include the experimental there. So we can control the treatment by other questions in the questionnaire. We just put the list experimental and don't have questions about gender equality in the questionnaire. So we are still working on the other questions that we have about like democracy and other behavior. And one of the things that I said about I comment with my supervisor is that could be a fact about Dilma and about the rejection of Dilma and the rejection about the politics, because we have this atmosphere here in Brazil now that the politics is being rejected. So we can have this effect, but unfortunately I can't control my treatment here just looking for Dilma's questions, because we don't have that. And Amy, we can compare because we don't have another survey about the youngest in Florianópolis, and we can compare for the others surveys, because the age was very different. The age in the survey start with 18 and our studies have about 16 and 17. So I didn't want to compare that with the age that we have in other surveys. So I think I respond all the questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your participation, Renata. And Juan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Giovanni. Taylor?
Okay, well, thank you very much for the comments. And let me pick, I will sort of simply have taken note of some of them and respond to some others. So Fabrizio mentioned the possibility that voters see the opposition or the other alternatives as corrupt in addition to the incumbent. I think this is a very important point. This is something that's been highlighted in the existing literature using vignette experiments. It's been tested in some instances, and there's been support that's been shown, a paper and done in Peru in particular, for smaller effects when people think that the opposition is also corrupt. Looking at the cases, and we did some of these case studies, in some instances it's quite clear that the opposition is as corrupt, if not more so. You can look at their sort of history of various transgressions. And you know, in other instances, they're fairly clean. I would like to highlight though that, you know, half of our respondents were in municipalities where the mayor's accounts were approved. They were getting positive information, right? And so, you know, if you tell them the mayor, if you give them a signal that implies the mayor is malfeasant or corrupt, they might assume that the opposition is the same. If you tell them that, if you give them a signal that implies that the mayor is a good performer and honest, they wouldn't presumably assume that the opposition is also, right? And so half of our respondents receiving positive information, which should contradict their sort of default assumption about politicians, if what you're saying is true, and we still see null effects there. Fabrizio mentioned figure 12, which was my the bar plot showing the most important issue for voters and for candidates. And I just wanted to underscore that, you know, recall what I showed from the LAPOP data, that about 10% of Brazilians at the national level are consistently spontaneously mentioning corruption as the biggest national problem. We asked the same question at the municipal level, and they're simply mentioning other things, right? And we did focus groups, and like, people care about the fact that the local health center doesn't have doctors, right? People care about the fact that they have no jobs. I mean, these are the things that they talk about when they're evaluating local governments. You know, not corruption and malfeasance issues. Several people mentioned the fact that we're not really necessarily talking about corruption, and this is absolutely true, and this is why malfeasance and not corruption is in the title of the paper. The accounts are most often rejected for things that wouldn't normally be considered corruption. These are not politicians enriching themselves. As Amy Erica pointed out, you know, it's often sort of violating budgeting rules like the law of fiscal responsibility, right? Which for instance says you can't spend more than 54% of the municipal salary on public employees. If you do spend more than that on public employees, you're giving people jobs and they might be happy, right? And so that could work to your benefit. And so I think these things are all an important part of understanding why we don't see effects. I would like to underscore a couple things. First in our defense. So first of all, we do show in the vignette experiment that informing people about the rejection of accounts for reasons of budgeting, impropriety, irregularities in the budget, right, which is what we say, generates the exact same effects as Winters and White Shapiro found when they informed people that the mayor was accepting a bribe, right? Now, it might be the case that in this hypothetical world, all negative information has the same effect, but in the real world, voters would punish corruption more than they would punish the rejection of accounts, which most often happens for other reasons. We don't know that. We didn't run a field experiment that informed voters about egregious incidents of corruption in which, the mayor was stealing and got caught. But the fact is that those types of occurrences are much less common. And when they happen, there's grounds for legal action, removing the mayor from office in the middle of a term, and even potentially, imprisoning him, right? The rejection of accounts is a weaker area of horizontal accountability in Brazil, especially with the recent Supreme Court decision ruling that the ficha limpa law is only going to apply in the case of executive accounts rejection when the legislature also upholds the decision, right? And so this is an area in which voters exercising vertical accountability based on this information is particularly important, and unfortunately we don't see it happening. And then finally, on David's question, I really like the point about selection, and we do know, we sort of observed this process of candidate registration, who opted in, who opted out. A number of mayors with rejected accounts chose not to run again. In part, I think some of them were anticipating being disqualified because of the ficha limpa law, which then unexpectedly was weakened by the Supreme Court right around the time of the candidate registration deadline, but sort of too late for them to act. But we did do a full-scale N equals 2000 pilot study in July, presenting the same information and asking about intended vote. And we did that in all of the municipios where the mayor was eligible to run for re-election. And so we found similar results there. And so I really appreciate the question, because I think we will now, in future revisions, mention specifically the results from the pilot and the fact that it doesn't matter whether your mayor chose to run for re-election or was simply eligible to run for re-election. Thank you.
Thank you, Taylor. I think we're done with this panel. Thank you so much to the participants, and now we move on to the next one.
Okay, we have a brief break. We are already 10 minutes behind, but 10 minutes is not so bad, I guess. I would suggest that even though we are 10 minutes behind, we still take a break, I think. And we'll come back in 10 minutes.
Okay, my thanks, everybody. I've got to run off and teach. I hope the rest of the conference is spectacular.
Thank you, Taylor.
Thanks. I don't know.
Okay, we're going to Okay, no, don't worry, I can get it.
Hello?
Hello. Are we ready to start?
Yes, I believe we are.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the second installment of this exciting conference. So my name is Maggie. I'm the chair of this session from the US side. So I would like to introduce the presenter from our side, Gladys Mitchell-Walthour. She's the visiting assistant professor of public policy and political economy in the Department of Africology at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. She received her PhD at the University of Chicago, and she has published a number of articles related to racism and Afro-Brazilian political behavior and opinion, racial identification, affirmative action. And today she's going to talk with us her paper titled An Intersectional Analysis of Bolsa Familia Recipients' Presidential Satisfaction of Dilma Rousseff in 2012 and 2014 and Political Trust. And she will also be serving as a discussant on Daniel Capistrano's paper. So which, without much ado, I'll let you start.
Okay, thank you. Thank you to both organizers for this conference. This is just a wonderful idea. So I'm very happy that I'm presenting. So as mentioned, I'm going to discuss an intersectional analysis of Bolsa Familia recipients' presidential satisfaction of Dilma Rousseff in 2012 and 2014, and political trust as well. In the political science literature, there's a debate about whether Bolsa Familia should be considered a form of patronage, or if there's some type of clientelistic relationship between voters and those who receive the program. Also during the 2014 campaign, some citizens stereotyped Bolsa Familia recipients as lazy people who wanted handouts from the government. Northeasterners, who are predominantly Black and Brown, were stereotyped as uneducated voters who were uncritical of Rousseffi, since they benefited from this program. Simone Bonn argues that Bolsa Familia voters, or you know, this relationship is not a form of clientelism. Natasha Sugiyami and Wendy Hunter do not find evidence of clientelism and argue there is less clientelism in Brazil today than in the past. Brian Fried also finds evidence that clientelism is in decline. However, Cesar Zucco Jr. and Timothy Power find a relationship between the program and support for former president Lula. So in these debates, some people are saying, yes, it is. Others are saying, no, we don't find that evidence. What I found interesting is that in the discussion of Bolsa Familia, there usually is no mention of intersectional identities of race, class, and gender. And this is despite that 73% of those receiving Bolsa Familia are Black and Brown. So basically what I'm trying to do is contribute to the argument by also saying, well, we should also consider a more intersectional approach. So in the paper, I discuss Black feminist theory, especially as it is articulated by Black Brazilian women. And then I talk about the importance of it, because the ideal is that when you consider intersectional identities, that Black and Brown women will have a different perspective due to their race, class, and gender positions in society. So my hypothesis is that Black women will be more critical of the president than other racial and gender groups due to their race, class, and gender, and due to the discrimination they have faced due to these intersectional identities. So I'm first just going to talk about my descriptive results, and then I will talk about the order logistic models that I run. I'm relying on 2012 and 2014 LAPOP data. Unfortunately, the 2010 survey asked questions about Lula, so I can't use that survey to look at opinions on Dilma Rousseff. The survey question is, speaking of the current government, what do you think of the work of President Dilma? And respondents could choose very good, good, neither good nor bad, bad or very bad. So if we just look at all those surveyed, what you see is that, in fact, most people say she's doing very good or good. However, when you look at those saying very bad and bad, 15% of Black women say that she's doing very bad. And that's compared to 6% of Black men, 6% of brown men, 6% of white women, and 6% of white men, and 3% of brown women. So that's the general population. When we look at Bolsa Familia recipients, or those who live in Bolsa Familia households, 25% of Black women say she is doing very bad. This is the highest percentage of all racial and gender groupings. So Black women are 12.5 times more likely than brown men and brown women to say she is doing a very bad or bad job. And they are 2 times more likely than white men and 6.25 times more likely than white women to believe she is doing a bad or very bad job. So again, these are just descriptive statistics here, but you can see that perhaps there is something going on in terms of how Black women, Bolsa Familia recipients, are evaluating the president. So the next thing I do is to run a ordered logistic regression, considering a number of variables. So basically, again, I'm looking at, you know, satisfaction of Rousseffi. So I consider income, education, gender, kind of the usual demographics or demographic characteristics. I also consider discrimination and political party. And then I have this interaction variable of race and gender. Race and gender is not statistically significant, but it is in the direction that I expected. Racial discrimination is statistically significant. So if you have experienced racial discrimination, you are less likely to say that she has done a very good or good job. The other thing that I just quickly looked at was to consider this interaction variable when you look at trust in the Brazilian political system. And what I find there, again, is that discrimination is statistically significant. And in that case, Black and brown women, so the interaction variable is statistically significant. Black and brown women are less likely than other gender and racial groupings to believe that their rights are protected a lot compared to the other groups. And so basically I do the same thing for the 2014 data. However, there's something very different in the 2014 data because it changes. So in the 2014 data, among Bolsa Familia households, white men have the highest disapproval of Dilma Rousseff. So part of the paper is trying to figure out why you have such a dramatic change. And so I talk about this legislation regarding domestic workers or domestic workers' rights. And in Brazil, most domestic workers are Black and brown women. So perhaps due to that legislation, there was more support for the president. I'm, of course, open to hearing what others, you know, may think would have caused the change. And also in the logistic regression, the interaction variable was not statistically significant. And again, I'm interested in finding out why there was that change when we just consider the descriptive statistics. So I will end there.
Thank you.
So Adriana, you have the floor.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Adriana. I will be organizing the second session here from the Brazilian side. And I would like to introduce you, our presenter and our discussant. Our presenter of this second session is Daniel Capistrano. He received his PhD in social sciences from the Center for research and graduate studies on the Americas at the University of Brasília. He's a researcher at the National Institute for Education, Educational Research and Studies. He's also the Vice Coordinator of World Value Surveys Brazil. And our discussant is Professor Tatiana Vargas Maia. She is professor at the Social Memory and Cultural Heritage Graduate Program and at the International Relations and History Undergraduate Programs at La Salle University Center. Tatiana received her PhD in political science from the Southern Illinois University, Carbondale, and her master's degree in international relations from Federal University of Rio Grande do Sul. Dr. Tatiana is also a researcher at the Mariposas Research Group, Gender, Sexuality, and Feminism. So please, Danielle, could you start your presentation, please?
So thank you, Adriana. I'd like first to thank Professor Henrique, Adriana, Alberta, and all the people involved in the organization of this conference. I'd like to jump to the beginning of my presentation. I brought this image for you to begin. For those who are not familiar with this landscape, this is not Porto Alegre, unfortunately not. Yeah, you have great academics, but not the best beaches, unfortunately. I just brought this image because of this gentleman seated on this bench. This is a statue of the poet Carlos Drummond de Andrade. I brought this image of him because one of his poems, called The New Man, gives a very nice illustration of some ideas that I discuss in my paper. So the name of this poem is The New Man, O Novo Homem. It talks about how man in the future will be, if I can put the poem on the screen, could you please, next slide, actually just a click, yes. It talks about so how man will be made in a laboratory in the future. So this new man will be educated, will have money, but both all these things, he will be independent. He will have no bonds with the past or with his family. So this new man brings this idea that I want to discuss in my work. I'd like to remember that this poem was written in the 60s, and the same modernist that inspired the construction of the city of Brasília also inspired poets like Drummond with this futuristic idea of the new, of the rupture from the past. So I believe that in a way the same modernist idea view inspired the work of Ronald Engelhardt in the political science. I'm going to explain a little bit further this argument. So for this author, Ronald Engelhardt, the human development follows a universal and common after the Second World War, social and economic development caused major change in individual values. So these new societies that emerge are formed by individuals who do not emphasize survival values. They do not give priority to economic and physical security anymore. These new societies are pluralist. They are characterized by high emphasis on self-expression, on tolerance, and on participation as well. So in this perspective, this movement is also followed by a change in political values. Could you please click again? In political values, the self-expression values make individuals give more importance to civic autonomy in place of state authority. And this is important for what I'm going to discuss in my paper. So in his own words, Engelhardt and Welzel argue that favorable existential conditions contribute to emerging self-expression values that give individual liberty priority over collective discipline, human diversity over group conformity, and civic autonomy over state authority. So basically, what I have discussed in my paper, I wanted to try to test two things. First, if in Brazil, if it's possible to verify an increase in the level of self-expression values, so this movement, and also, this is the second test, if this increase in self-expression values is also followed by a decrease in the emphasis for the state authority. So for the first question, the answer would be yes, there is a clear increase in the proportion of Brazilians who are post-materialists and emphasize self-expression values. This chart here shows higher average of self-expression values in younger cohorts who are, oops, could you please go back? Yeah, and on the right of the horizontal axis. On the other hand, for the second question, if we are moving towards less emphasis on the state authority, I couldn't identify the expected decrease in the emphasis of the state authority over time. The main variable that we have in the World Value Survey to assess the level of support for the state authority is the following question that you see there. How would you place your views on this scale of 1 to 10, in which 1 means the people should take more responsibility to provide for themselves, and 10 meaning the government to take more responsibility to ensure that everyone is provided for. So we would expect that less emphasis on state, the support for the state authority would be the lower values there. So looking at the distribution of the answers in Brazil over the past 3 decades, we cannot affirm that there was a clear movement from the right to the left of this scale, as we would expect from this hypothesis of Engelhardt. In other words, the main finding of this work is that despite the increase in the emphasis on self-expression values among Brazilians, this is not followed by less emphasis on the social support for the state authority. So, intrigued by this unexpected outcome, I went a little bit further. I went back to these two hypotheses and considered some possible explanations for that. Why is it possible to observe a clear trend from survival to self-expression, but we cannot verify this same trend here from state authority to civic autonomy? As you can see from this chart, countries that show higher levels of self-expression are the ones where we find lower average in the government responsibility scales, with a high correlation between these two variables. So the work of the Gaúcho, Raimundo Faoro, provides relevant insights to explain the support for the state in Brazil. In his book, Os Donos do Poder, The Owners of Power, Raimundo Faoro describes how the Brazilian patrimonial state has been the main reference and conductor of Brazilian society since the colonial times. So all the social hopes are invested in the state, particularly from the most vulnerable groups who seek for protection. In this context, the Brazilian acute social inequality plays an important role, according to Faoro. So, coming to conclusion, I used this insight from Faoro and tested the influence of different variables on the support for the state through regression analysis. The World Value Survey data indicates that in Brazil, self-expression and individual autonomy are not statistically relevant to explain the support for the state. On the other hand, views on income inequality are more important to understand this variation. So, closing my presentation in Faoro's words, so the economic and social development that we experienced in the 20th century was not enough to overcome the influence of the strong traditional political culture subject of the state in Brazil. Apparently, as he says, the new wine powered in the old wine skin did not break. So we could translate that in our words, that we could think that the political culture matters more than we think. So thank you.
So, Danielle, I really enjoyed reading your paper. And actually, some of the questions that I had were cleared up in your presentation. So, one of the questions that I had was the relationship between materialist values and post-materialist values related to secular, rational, or self-expression values, but you just cleared that up basically in your PowerPoint. So I would just say make it more clear in the actual paper. The other thing that I found in this paper that I think would be beneficial to your readers is if you would give more context to what is actually going on in Brazil now, and also Brazil's political past. So you're making a lot of comparisons with European countries and advanced industrial countries. And I know a lot of the theories that you rely on are basically, you know, based in those countries. So that's why I think that context is so important. I think it's really important to mention, you know, Brazil's authoritarian past. And also there are, you know, current scholars such as Brian Pitts, who makes the argument that the recent impeachment is yet another example of Brazil's tendency toward authoritarianism. So again, just kind of bringing in the historical and recent context would help out. I found your finding really interesting in terms of less educated, also women, young, and non-white people were more likely to support the state. So I would just like you to spend, you know, a little bit more time on that. And then of course you also mentioned Feodoro's work and Cardoso's work, so I won't go over that again. But in terms of your findings, I think on support for state authority along with your variable regarding inequality, I think you could also look at some of the scholarship in American politics. So for example, Michael Dawson's 1994 work, he discusses the fact that African Americans have more reliance on the state or support the state more because of civil rights legislation. I think in the Brazilian context, you could look at something similar, not necessarily for civil rights legislation, but if you think about Bolsa Família, so you talked about inequality, so you have to rely on the state for that. Also recent legislation, you know, such as 2012 affirmative action legislation. So, you know, I think these type of legislations aren't, you know, they're not having an impact on the larger society, but they are definitely applicable to some of these people that you are talking about, right? Non-whites, less educated people, women, and young people. So I think just kind of looking at other theorists or political scientists, that their work might just kind of add to some of your findings.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'm going to turn to Professor Tatiana, who is going to make her comments on the paper presented by Professor Gladys.
Hello, thank you. Gladys, it was a pleasure to read your paper, especially because it dialogues a lot with my interests, research in gender and politics in Brazil. And in that sense, my comments, there are more questions because that I was left with after reading your paper, and that I would like you to explore more, because I think you have a very interesting material here ahead. First, I would like to begin with your hypothesis. You work specially with two hypotheses, which you define right on page 5 and page 6, in which you say that you're going to be comparing both the fact that you suppose that the fact that Black women will be more critical of Dilma Rousseff than any other racial or gender group. And hypothesis two is that Black women will be more less trustful of the Brazilian political system. And I do like a lot the way you set up your study, appealing to intersectional studies, especially Patricia Hill Collins. But I would like you to explore more theoretically on why you have that expectation. I found that in a sense, your paper was lacking on that development, on why we would see necessarily Black women being less satisfied with the specifically and with the political system as a whole. And on that, I do think that you could also compare or organize the presentation of your results, both the descriptive statistic and your analysis, your regression analysis, to compare both 2012 and 2014. It wasn't clear for me if you were willing to think or to demonstrate the development of these two issues, satisfaction and trust, between 2 years, right, from 2012 to 2014. And it does seem that you do have interesting results that for me, they're not clearly, let's say, brought to life in your conclusion, especially. You see that your main conclusion is that Black and Brown women in Bolsa Família households are less trustful of the Brazilian political system than other groups. And you do seem to have that in a sense when you compare especially your descriptive analysis, right? The descriptive satisfaction. But reading your tables, especially comparing table 6 with table 2, it seems that you have interesting results here that you didn't actually compare or analyze in your paper. For instance, that the fact that Brown women, the satisfaction with Dilma falls a lot, right? From 72 to 52. And yet the ones that rank Dilma performance as being bad and very bad fall from 14 to 2. So there is an interesting shift on people that seems to be hanging in the middle of neither good or bad. And you even said in your presentation that the main change we see is regarding white men. So I do think you have some interesting results that you could explore more. And then I would even like to hear from you now, because I'm very curious of what you think, and I didn't think you had maybe the space or the time to fully develop in the article. And following some of David's remarks on our first round of presentations, I do think that some further issues you could develop are, for instance, how discrimination reflects on Dilma, right? Being our first female president. And also, how do you think, and you mentioned this very briefly in your paper, that Dilma, in a sense, inherited or was elected mostly due to Lula's popularity? And how does that play on her evaluation from 2012 to 2014? Moreover, does the gender of the president, right, matters in this evaluation? And perhaps we could have a comparative study between Lula and Dilma regarding satisfaction with both Bolsa Família, but also trusting government in Brazil. I really like how you set up your paper, mostly drawing a lot from intersectionality and Black feminist theory. And I do think you have a lot of to explore here. Just a couple of very, very focused questions. I didn't see the regression, the variable religion in your regressions. Don't you think that maybe
it's a significant variable to think about politics in Brazil and satisfaction with the government, especially in the past decade, we've seen a shift in how religion interacts with politics in Brazil. And maybe that could give you some other insights to your study. And more than that, I see that you use political party in your regressions, and I kept thinking, does this mean that political party could be used as a proxy for Lula's power, in a sense that people more affiliated or closely associated to the Labour's party would be more willing to evaluate Dilma in a more favorable light than others? Well, that's it. Those are my main concerns, not concerns, but my main notes on your paper. I do think it was really interesting, and I do think you have a lot to explore here. Thank you.
Okay. So the floor is open for question.
I want to have a question for Gladys. Thank you for your presentation and your paper. This is really interesting how you see differences in support between 2012 and 2014 surveys. And my question is, do you think the political campaign that happens in 2014 that, as you say, racializes to some extent Bolsa Família, generates this kind of grouping among the racial groups you're seeing? So in 2012, where you have maybe municipal elections, but that is not relevant as a category, you have kind of your perception about government and Dilma is based on your experiences of discrimination, et cetera, but once you come to 2014 and all of a sudden there is this strategy of making the people that receive Bolsa Família lazy and racializing this context, makes people start grouping and saying, well, you know, I mean, I might actually have to support Dilma on this one because it's Bolsa Família, but it's also the quotas and all these other things. So the campaign kind of separates racial groups in Brazil, saying, well, I have the PT is on my side, whereas the others, maybe not so much.
I also have a couple of questions for Gladys. And I found this a really interesting, important paper. Partly because from my own reading, I find these you're right, there's these ambivalent or ambiguous results about race and voting behavior, race and political attitudes. So a couple questions for you moving forward, and I echoing what Juan said, that I find the contrast between 2012 and 2014 to be very puzzling. And so working that out, I think, as you move forward is really important, particularly the reversal in the opinion of Black men and Black women. And my suggestion is that, which I think builds on what Juan was saying, is that the effects you find may be driven by an omitted variable, which is quite simply evaluation of the economy, which tanked for everybody in 2014. So I don't know what that would do with the results, but you don't have that in your model. And one thing we know about presidential evaluation anywhere, anytime, is evaluation of the economy generally, the sociotropic, or you know, me, how I'm doing right now, and that may be particularly affected Black men, Black women in different ways in 2012 and 2014. So those really need to be included. I also had some confusion about the results themselves. You've got several variables that are many times the size of several coefficients that are many times the size of the standard errors, yet they're not marked as significant. So in particular, it was income and education, for example, that seemed to have a huge effect, but you didn't mark, I just don't know, maybe it's just a typo. I was just surprised that especially in 2014, income is not negative and significant. The rich people really dislike Dilma, right? So just kind of wondering. There's another comment about interactive coefficients, and especially in a nonlinear model, like ordered logit, you can't interpret the raw output of an interacting coefficient as significant or not, because it could be significant at some levels of the independent variable and insignificant at others. It's just, I had to learn this too, because it screwed me up in some of my papers. So the paper by, actually go to Matt Golder's website, where he's got this really nice clean state of code, which will output the results at different levels of the independent variable with the standard error bars at different levels of the IV. So you can see like, oh, it might be at some levels it's significant, other levels it's not. And that would really help make your results more precise. And the last thing I say is, in the conclusion, you veer away from where you start. And I think I always have my editor hat on, right? Is reviewers are gonna notice this. You've got this really strong start about feminist theory, intersectionality, and at the end you mush together pretos and partos and men and women. And so I was just kind of wondering what happened to the emphasis on intersectionality with the focus on people who self-define as pretos. And so as you're moving forward, I just, you know, that tension has to be resolved. That's a really important contribution you're trying to make, right? So that's just, I noted that. And I was thinking, what could you comment on that?
Thank you, Juan and David, for the question.
Okay, I would like to open for questions from our audience here in Brazil. Does anyone would like to propose a question?
Hello. I have a comment to Daniel. I think the title of the paper does not reflect its contents. Instead of support for the states, the paper is about preference for a big state, because non-support for the states would mean a preference for secession or dissolution of Brazil. Non-preference for the states, non-support for the states would mean the secession, separation of Brazil, or the dissolution of Brazil. The state Brazil is not on the question. The people are in question how big the state must be, should be. A big state that you protect the people, or a small state that you only protect the property. The state itself is not questioned.
Not directly.
Not directly. Yes. And another, at the same, instead of state authority, you should think, talk about social responsibility of the state. The same question. And let's think about taking together all the answers of all four questionnaires might be problematic because the national context was not the same in each year. I think you should at least add the year as a damage control for contests.
Anyone else?
Danielle. I ask if the problem with the conclusion, if it's not that for Engelhardt, a civic view is an individualistic view, but it's possible to think in a civic statistic view, where for people, the state is important, but it's a civic view, just not individualistic, as in the Engelhardt theory.
Have another question?
Okay, my question goes to Daniel as well. So thank you for your presentation. I was curious about the results that we presented, because in time that you show that the population expects something from the state or expects a bigger state or something more, the level of confidence on our institutions are really going down. So I was wondering about what are your thoughts on that.
I believe that's pretty much it here in Brazil. I believe you can start your remarks there. Hello. I believe that it's pretty much it here in Brazil. You can start your remarks there.
Okay, I will go ahead and respond to as many as I can. So thank you everyone for all the feedback. In terms of Adriana's concerns, so I developed the first and the second hypotheses due to the literature, especially the literature on how Black Brazilian women articulate intersectionality. And so basically what a lot of theorists or scholars and activists were saying is that in Brazil, even when you look at these intersections of, you know, race, class, and gender, you still have to look at differences among Black women. So that low-income Black women might actually have a different perspective, just kind of on the world, than even, you know, educated and middle-class Black women. And so since I'm really trying to focus on Bolsa Familia recipients, my thought was that those most vulnerable, right? So with very low income levels, sometimes, you know, low education as well, but low income levels also with perhaps experiences based on race and gender, that they would have this unique perspective in evaluating the president. So that was the reason that I thought they would actually be more dissatisfied than, you know, the other groupings, and also would be less trustworthy of the state, was due to, you know, the group that I was looking at. This is also related to one of David's comments regarding, I think, differences in when we consider income and education. So and you were mentioning, you know, rich people are very different than lower income, but when we're looking at Bolsa Familia recipients, there really are no rich people, you know, in the sample. So I think the other comments that that you gave, Adriana, are really important in terms of just fleshing some of these things out. So, and especially the result in terms of white men being more dissatisfied. I think that also goes along with Juan's comment. Oh, over there. Juan's comments in terms of the 2014 election being highly racialized. And it, I mean, you know, as an outsider, it looked very different than other elections I've seen in Brazil. It looked more American in that way, in terms of how Bolsa Familia recipients, it was very similar to this ideal of the welfare queen that people talk about in Black feminist thought in the United States, where, you know, Black women are racialized and seen as poor and wanting, you know, handouts. So I think that could be one reason that you see this high level of dissatisfaction among, or lower levels among Black women, Black and brown women, but higher levels among white men, coupled with, you know, sexism and things like this. So dissatisfaction with a woman president, I mean, to be explicit. So they were more critical while, you know, other groups were perhaps less critical due to that campaign. I think this was something David mentioned also, evaluation of economy. That is definitely a variable that I can add in. I have another paper where I'm looking at how Afro-Brazilians evaluate the economy in terms of personal experiences with discrimination. So if you have experienced discrimination, you are more likely to have a negative evaluation of the economy. So I think I kind of was compartmentalizing things, but I think this is relevant to this paper as well. So that is definitely a variable that I will add in. I also think religion is something I can add in, you know, just to see what happens. The problem that I have, and I think this is also related to David's question about some of the methodological concerns in terms of interpretation, is that, so my sample is already getting small since I'm only looking at Bolsa Familia recipients. And then when I break them up into these groupings, it just keeps shrinking and shrinking. So when I added in political party, you know, it got smaller. And so that's why I'm kind of skeptical of some of the results. And if I add in religion, that might make it, you know, even smaller. So that's some of my concerns, but I will definitely check out the person you mentioned, Matt Golden, Golder. I will check out his website.
Penn State.
Okay. All right, thank you. Those are all my, that's my response.
So I'm going to turn now to Daniel to make his final remarks. Please, Daniel.
Thanks, Adriana. So I'm going to begin with the last question about the confidence in institutions. Yes, you're right. If we look at the results of these surveys, we can indeed observe lower confidence in some state institutions. And that's my question here. My point here is that if you look at confidence in the parliament, confidence in parties, yes, maybe the government, you will find like lower and lower confidence. However, if you look, for example, the confidence on armored forces, on the army, to a lesser degree on police, for example, you will see that it is very stable and actually rising. So it's, and it brings me to Jackson's question. So yes, I do in the paper some discussion about what I'm considering state here. I'm using the term state in a very loose way. It's not well defined, but on purpose, given that it's not clear for the respondent. It's not clear for the individual who's responding the survey exactly what means state, exactly what means government. In general, I do believe that your suggestion would be more precise in the sense it would be better, the social responsibility of the state. But in a way, these questions were formulated in order to oppose the state with the individual, with the people. So this is the idea that less emphasis on the state. I focus on that because there is this opposition created by the questionnaire between the government, the state. I discuss a little bit that, and the individual and people in general. And it brings me to the other question related to the view of civic autonomy. So yes, there's this opposition created between the state and individual, the state and people. It will be difficult to find some position, as you said, that could be Brazilian's position. This is a very good hypothesis that we are moving towards civic autonomy, but also emphasizing the role, a more statist, as you said, this term is I think it's interesting, the statist civic autonomy, as opposed to this individualistic civic autonomy that indeed is something that is behind the whole rationale of this hypothesis from Engelhardt. And finally, I'd like to thank, well, all the comments and questions, but especially Gladys, for all the contributions. I have to clarify that this paper is based on two chapters of my dissertation, so I have to make it a bit skinny paper. But yes, I think I have exaggerated a little bit in this diet, so I cut it too much. So I think I do believe that I have to include some discussions that I took out. For example, I just realized after sending the paper that wasn't that clear the relationship between the materialist and post-materialist and self-expression values that I tried to clarify here in this presentation. But all the comments and the contributions, I took note of all this the references you made. Gladys, thank you very much for that. And that's it. Thank you.
Session. Thank you very much for everybody's comment and for the presenter.
Okay, we are still running 10 minutes behind schedule, so I think we should still take a 10-minute break because we all need it. Okay, so we'll see you in 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Gente, Roberta, Carla, Amy, are you ready there? Okay, thank you. Well, let's now hear the lecture of Dr. Marcelo Baqueiro, with the title of Inertial Democracy in Latin America. Could it be a sociological law? Well, let me present Professor Marcelo Baqueiro to the people who doesn't know him. Dr. Baqueiro is full professor at Federal University of Rio Grande do Sul and coordinator of the Latin America Research Center, NUPESAL. Dr. Baqueiro studies democracy, social capital, political culture, political participation, and political parties in Latin America. And he is one of the founders of the contemporary political culture studies in Brazil. He has published numerous books and articles during his career. And his latest book is Which Democracy for Latin America? Are Social Capital and Empowerment the Answers? He has taught at several institutions, among them the Florida State University, the Central University of Ecuador, the Latin America Center at Oxford University, and the École des Études en Sciences Sociales in Paris. He is currently working, developing his concept of inertial democracy, and we are glad to hear him today. Important to say that I am proud to say that he was my advisor during my PhD. And well, Dr. Marcelo will talk about speech about 20 minutes, and after that, we can open to questions and comments. Please, Dr. Marcelo.
Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. I thank Professor Enrique for the kind comments about myself. And going into the talk that I'm going to give today, I will say initially that the title that I presented to be debated in this meeting is somewhat pretentious. When I say, could inertial democracy, could it be a sociological law? It's pretentious because I am not presenting a theory, not even an outline of a theory. What I'm trying to do is to present a sociological concept that I believe could be very useful as a mechanism of understanding some of the dilemmas of democratic construction in Latin America that, in my opinion, were not analyzed by the traditional orthodox approaches. So what I'm going to do is delineate my presentation in three parts. The first part, I'm going to delineate how I see Latin America in the last years. In the second part, I'm going to present this concept of inertial democracy from the positive point of view, and also pointing out some limitations of this concept. And in the third part, I'm going to test if this concept works in Latin America and what are the contributions that this concept could bring for political sciences, especially in trying to find new ways of, let's say, participating in an effort to overcome the social and economic problems that we presently face in our countries. Just let me take the chronometer so I can check my time. So, beginning. The history of political evolution in Latin America shows a cyclical pattern of economic growth with modest gains in the social dimension, followed by periods of economic crisis. This pattern has had an impact in the political underdevelopment of this region, in the aggravation of the social conditions for the majority of the populations. This cyclical pattern, that is economic crisis and economic progress, has generated a contradictory image about the political dynamic of this region. Depending on the period that an individual country is studied, the conclusions can be either positive or negative. If compared with other countries, they can be considered politically and economically stable or unpredictable
unstable, and inefficient. If analyzed with different theoretical perspectives, a country can be considered democratically consolidated or as an incomplete democracy. These disagreements have produced research about Latin America that, depending on the theoretical approach utilized, can generate enthusiasm with the future or as uncertainty and hopelessness with the social situation. This shows that economic development and democratic construction do not occur in a vacuum. Economic choices depend on rules, institutions, and social constraints that are mediated by the political process. The underlying logic, therefore, is that an environment of governance with stability, the rule of law, and social cooperation foments the creation of wealth and good quality of life for citizens. I argue, and this is the main argument of my paper, I argue that this has not been the case for Latin America, where democracy and good government are not synonymous. On the contrary, the tendency has been the presence of a formal procedural democracy accompanied by growing conflicts between state and society, the proliferation of violence, and the unprecedented growth of corruption. In a general sense, these countries have not been able to guarantee a congruence between economic, social, and cultural development, with social justice and solid institutions typical of representative democracies. What it seems, the picture that appears based on this consideration, is that public authorities elected by the popular vote become indifferent to the true reality of Latin American societies, where continues to prevail social, economic, and political inequality. The concentration of wealth, the rise of unemployment, and the institutionalization of corrupt political practices. Under these circumstances, I believe that it becomes very difficult to talk about democratic consolidation in Latin America. I argue that political and economic democracy are sides of the same coin. They cannot be treated separately. A formal substantive democracy will hardly become a reality in a society where the economic power is concentrated in the hands of the few, which is the case, I believe, in most of our countries. I further advance that in this context, the influence of citizens in politics is a fiction, because decisions are taken by those that have political and economic power. What I'm basically saying is that the vote is merely a ritual and does not translate into an effective participation by the demos. Therefore, my thesis that I present in the book is that the incongruence between economic and political development generates a type of democracy that, while advances on the formal side, that is, in the institutional side, on the procedural side, it experiments political underdevelopment, producing what I call, and I introduced the new concept, inertial democracy. In this direction, my effort is to make sense of stability of instability in Latin America. I would like to repeat that so that you don't get confused. My effort is to make sense of the stability of instability in Latin America. I seek to demystify the idea that the region is presently in a process of democratic consolidation, despite the good formal representative democratic indicators. I argue that an egalitarian democracy goes beyond the formal procedures, because it involves simultaneously the need to find an equilibrium between the formal and the social, or we are destined to live an endless democratic transition. The basic idea that I put forward for the debate is that part of the problem of Latin America can be attributed to the existence of an inertial democracy, which principal characteristic is the asymmetry between two dimensions, economy and politics. That need to evolve at the same time over parallel to each other in order to achieve not only a formal, but a substantive democracy. In these circumstances, I argue that the consequence materializes in an inertial democracy where the traditional status quo prevails despite institutional formal advancements. So that's basically the first part of my argument, contextualizing what's, in my opinion, is going on in Latin America and why some of the traditional efforts to explain why democracy does not seem to work properly in our countries, fall short of identifying some real causes for the instability of these countries. In this sense, I introduce the concept of inertial democracy. What is inertial democracy? I'm going to try to define it briefly because of the time limits. The concept of inertia, I borrow from the field of physics. And in physics, inertia is described as a movement of two objects that move in the same space at the same speed, and they are going always in the same direction. The inertia occurs when one of those objects experiments, because of somewhat of a disruption, experiments a retarding effect. While one is going ahead, the other one begins to reduce its speed, and therefore you have a vacuum and space of inertia. Yeah. Trying to make it more clear, in the field of economics, the concept of inertial inflation was created to characterize a situation where in periods of high inflation, the prices are adjusted according to the rates of inflation. So inflation goes up and the prices goes up. So you have a parallel movement that inflation fits the increases of prices and vice versa. When governments try to stabilize the economy, the first thing they do is to try to stabilize inflation. Now, the inertia emerges in the field of economics when, despite the efforts of stabilizing and achieving somehow the reduction of inflation, people internalize values and develop a memory of inflation that even though that economy is stabilized, they continue to adjust the prices because of the inflation memory. Okay. So that characterizes an inertial inflation. Transmuting that concept to political theory, especially to democratic theory, what I try to show and I argue is that traditionally, political theory has suggested that democratic economic development should develop parallel with political development. So therefore, as the economy grows, as the economy concentrates wealth, the spillover of effects of the economic development should affect in an equal proportion the political dimensions. That is, if we have wealth, we have political stability. That was the classical principle of political theory. What happens in emerging countries and punctually in Latin America? What we observe is that from the polyarchic point of view, that is from the formal point of view, all the international organizations agree that Latin America has advanced significantly in the formal dimension. To that point that most of the indexes of polyarchical democracy or formal indicators of democracy show Latin Americans as being countries practically consolidated in the democratic formal dimension. The problem is that to the naked eye, what we observe every day is that we can agree that we have formal institutions. We have a multi-party system. We have elections regularly. We have somewhat the acceptance of who is defeated in an electoral process as being and recognizing who is the victorious as the legitimate holder of power. However, in the social dimension, what we observe is the prevalence of clientelism, patrimonialism, privatism, and practices of corruption that grow at an unprecedented rate in Latin America. So we have a situation which many authors have called as hybrid democracy, which means that on the one side, we have electoral democracies consolidated, while at the same time, we have some civil rights that are not being recognized. And I will go further, I will say that the social dimension has not been resolved. This creates an asymmetry between economy and politics. Given this situation, and of all my readings of the different approaches of democratic theory and the different objectives of democratic theory, nowadays we probably have more objectives of democracy than countries that are democratic. So therefore you have all sort of qualifications for democracy in the world. I'm not going to enumerate all the objectives because we'll probably take 2 hours to do that. But I will say the main thing, the main objectives: incomplete democracy, hybrid democracy, delegative democracies, incomplete democracies, inefficient democracies, toxic democracies, and so on. All these theories, they converge in one point. They have somewhat different explanations for the different theories, but they converge in one point. And that point is the constatation that these democracies in the emerging countries have a weak relationship between state and society. And that's the main conclusion. And based on that, they propose a set of explanations and a set of solutions to reapproximate state and society. Well, I'm not satisfied with that. And just a small parenthesis, I'm part of a group that in the academic political sciences have been called, are called as the troublemakers.
Okay.
And what is a troublemaker? Troublemaker is it's a political scientist like me and some others in different parts of the world who are not satisfied with the political theoretical explanations of democracy in Latin America, and we believe that we have to make trouble. We really have to somewhat shake those ideas, proposing new explanations, not for the sake of proposing new objectives, but based on analysis, a deep analysis of what really seems to be occurring in our countries. And that's why it came to me that the idea of democratic inertia, could be a concept that could enlighten us as to the dilemmas that our countries are facing contemporarily. Because this is going to show very clearly that a practice that predominated in the last year in the economic, in the political science field, in which we identified two groups, the institutionalists and those who follow the theory of the political culture, do not communicate. So somewhat we have the image, who is an institutionalist, that all you need to do is to create institutions, create norms, create laws, that political development will appear automatically. Well, Latin American history has shown that this does not happen. So we have an asymmetry between economic formal development and incongruence with society that do not obey the laws. One of the things that is very interesting to note is that in Latin America, sometimes institutionalists argue that we need more laws, more institutions, more formal procedures. Well, there was a research conducted here in Brazil by a professor from France, that recently, French professor, he was here, but his name escapes me now. But he conducted a research in which he discovered that in Brazil, daily are produced 300 laws per hour. Obviously, this takes into account all the state instances, all levels. Municipality, state, federal, ministries. So the problem, and in the other countries in Latin America, is the same phenomenon. So the problem is not that we don't have laws. In fact, we have laws in excess. The problem is the congruence between the law and who obeys the law. This has created a distortion for many Latin Americanists that have identified a presumed tendency of civil disobedience of Latin Americans. I disagree with that. Yeah. Latin Americans are not prone to to not obey the laws. They are forced to not obey the laws for one simple reason. There is an absence of what I call a civic infrastructure. What's a civic infrastructure? For a law to be obeyed, the authorities or the government have to provide the infrastructure for the law to be obeyed. So if you create a law to protect the senior citizens, but you don't have any instance to implement those laws, people are going to violate the law, creating the image to Latin Americans outside of our frontiers that we are prone or we have the tendency to not obey the law. That's not the case. I disagree with that. Yeah. But this is the result of an asymmetry between what economics can do in providing that infrastructure, in what, in fact, it happens in reality. And in reality is that the absence of that civic infrastructure creates a political culture that's prone to be passive, alienated, hostile to political institutions, creating another asymmetry. What is that asymmetry? Is that although the expectations of the economies of the incumbent governments in Latin America is that all we have to do is invest more resources in the social areas that the problems will be resolved. Well, my research in what I try to do to illustrate the role of the national democracy as a limiting factor of the strengthening of social democracy in the maximalist sense, is that although we have modest economic growth, this modest economic growth does not revert in a sufficient manner for social investments. So what we have, and the empirical indicators that I used, empirical indicator for economic development, I use economic growth, the gross national product, and the Gini index, which measures inequality. From the point of view of social investments, I use indicators of investments in housing, education, health, and security. And what I find, in the 20 years of my research, I found that economic growth, in fact, is not a real economic growth. It's a nominal economic growth. I didn't think it was going to be so fast. the resources destined for social investments are obviously not enough. What we have in the last 20 years, it's a stagnation of social investments. Because the results of the modest economic growth observed in Latin America in the last 20 years have not reverted efficiently in social investments. And that's why it explains from the point of a national democracy that on the one hand, you have formal procedures going ahead, advanced significantly, and the political culture, people's attitudes and behavior regarding these political institutions is going on the opposite direction. So we have a situation of inertia. The obvious question is, well, most of us intuitively know that, but I do believe that the challenge for us as political scientists is to face the question of what can we do? What can we propose to overcome that inertia? And obviously I'm not going to go in detail because I have very 1 minute to finish my talk, but I will say that in my book, that it will be published in the next 2 months, I propose two exits. One, the role of social capital, and the role, and the second place, the role of emancipatory empowerment of society through a design of institutional experimentalism, which means going away from that traditional dichotomy of institutional links and political culture, but learning with history, as a professor of Cambridge, Hanju Chang, will say that we need to learn with history and we have to work with experimental innovations. Yeah. And I explain in my book what that means. Yeah. In synthesis, the main conclusion of my book is that we do have a situation of inertia democracy. The future of democracy is not very optimistic from my point of view, and I am not pessimistic. On the contrary, I believe that we do have the tools to face that challenge and somehow overcome those problems. All we have to do is get together and begin to talk. And perhaps this is the beginning of a dialogue promoted by Professor Enrique and the Professor Amy. Yeah. Perhaps this could be the beginning of a brainstorm, bringing these ideas that are not being discussed sufficiently in the academy as I would like to. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcelo. It was really, really interesting, your words. We are looking for your book. And Amy, I don't know if you have time for one comment, maybe from the American side. We are a bit late, but I don't know. It's up to you.
We are running a little bit late. Does anybody have one question or comment they want to ask? Okay. If we do have to make it very quick, but I was wondering, I never quite got the definition of inertial democracy. We talked a lot about it, but I didn't quite understand how you're measuring it and how you're defining it. So if you could very quickly, objectively, explain it, that would be great.
Okay, very quickly. Inertial democracy is a situation where you have modest economic growth, and stagnation of social investments, and underdevelopment of a political culture, which means attitudes and behaviors of the demos, which do not follow the liberal principles. So the inertia, you can identify it by, on the one hand, formal procedural advancements or electoral democracies, and on the other hand, the absence of societal legitimacy because individuals in these countries do not give credibility to those political institutions and especially politicians.
Thank you, Marcelo. Amy, it's up to you now. You can continue or we have a short break. It's up to you.
Do you want to have a question on your side or shall we go straight into?
I think we could question Professor Marcelo Baqueiro in another moment. We have time enough to do that. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Do we need a break quickly? What do we think? Need a break? Shall we go straight into David Samuels? Okay, David, it's all about you. Okay.
So this works. Okay. To the right or down?
To the right.
Okay. I should go to my own presentation. Ready? All right. Bom dia. Thanks to everyone. Obrigado a todos. Thanks for this great opportunity. Marcelo and Amy, Erica, to present for the first time some arguments, some results. We're for the first time putting everything together, Cesar and I, and trying to finish this book up, hopefully in the next couple months, get it out. So we start from the standard tripartite definition of political parties, parties as organizations, parties in government, and parties in the electorate. In the form of mass partisan identity, partisanship in people's minds. And so the purpose of the book is to advance a revisionist argument about the factors shaping voter attitudes and behavior in Brazil. Scott Mainwaring famously said that the party system is inchoate, that partisanship is weak in voters' minds. And I think the conventional wisdom about partisan attitudes in Brazil is exemplified by a phrase from a chapter that Lucio Henault, Barry Ames, and Andy Baker wrote, that they said that the key factors shaping voter attitudes are pork, pageantry, and performance. That is, that voters are mostly not partisans, and that candidates' personal qualities and their ability to bring home the bacon, as we say, and their performance in office are what determine their popularity and their electoral success. Parties don't matter in voters' mind, at least according to that conventional wisdom, because parties' programmatic commitments are weak, politicians campaign without reference to parties or their programs, et cetera, et cetera. So if you all remember one thing I say today, everything that I say, it's that this view is, if not entirely wrong, it's largely incomplete.
Brazil's party system in the electorate has, until very recently and understandably, has had a lot more coherence than most observers acknowledge, because partisan attitudes matter a lot more for Brazilian voters than most observers acknowledge. So I'm going to start with this. Eu vou apresentar livro de receitas, decifrando as delícias brasileiras, the coxinhas e mortadelas of Brazilian politics. And so if you're not familiar with this, these are words people use to curse each other. Xingar os outros, coxinhas, people who oppose the PT, mortadelas, which is mostly bologna in the United States. We don't see too much mortadela, are the petistas. And most of the book focuses on petismo and antipetismo. And you can see these words get even worse sometimes. These are the word petralha comes from these cartoon characters. In English, they're called the Beagle Boys. I had to learn this. I never saw this when I was a kid. Did you ever see these? You know, the Irmãos Metralha, they're known as in Brazil. They're the three dogs who try to steal from Scrooge McDuck in the Donald Duck pantheon. I'm more of a Captain America kind of comic book. Anyway, so, but these words are important because these partisan attitudes and anti-partisan attitudes are very real for millions and millions of Brazilians. Now this image, I have not been advancing my slides, have I? That's a problem. I'm sorry, these were the coxinhas and mortadelas. I gotta get a hang of this. This was the metralha. I'll get this. And this is now the image that I wanna advance on. I'm sorry, I have my slides here and they're on another machine. So what I love about this image, which is from Lula's 1998 campaign document, is it's a little boy hugging the Estrela do PT, becoming a petista is the idea. And this is deeply rooted in the concept of partisanship. You know, they don't study partisanship, the people who make these things up, right? But they intuit the nature of partisanship, that it is something that you get from your parents and your social context and that you keep for your lifetime. Very few people who become a partisan switch to another party or switch again. Now, sometimes you can turn it on or off, but very few people who become an affiliate of one party simply switch over the course of their lifetime between various parties. And so this is the nature that this image exemplifies for me, this understanding of partisanship. It sticks with you. But the argument in the book is that anti-partisanship exemplified by this image is very similar to positive partisanship. Now, this is a protest from Avenida Paulista from 2 years ago. But what we find, if you examine anti-partisan sentiment, that it has similar qualities to positive partisan sentiment, an almost religious-like quality for some people in its intensity, in the strength of the feelings about the out-group party, the other party that you dislike, in its absolutist qualities, this Manichaeist vision of the world, that the other side is not just disliked, but is an enemy, that they are morally suspect. Not just that they disagree about public policy, but literally morally suspect. They're living their lives incorrectly. That's how deeply felt these attitudes are. And so we start the book off with this conception of partisanship, this key theoretical point, that partisanship is a form of social identity. And social psychologists tell us that these social identities are about defining yourself in relation to other people, to other groups that both you like and dislike. And we call these in-groups and out-groups. And anyone who teaches Introduction to Comparative Politics will know that we don't necessarily use these terms, but we use these concepts when we discuss nationalism, when we discuss religious identity, when we discuss ethnic identity, and we discuss gender identity, that they're rooted in Weber's concept of status groups. And most research on partisanship only treats the concept of positive partisanship, the in-group form of identity. And if you have a strong psychological affinity for a party, you fall on the left side of this figure here, of this 2x2. Most research ignores the right side of the partisan identity two by two. That is, if you have no identification with a party, but you have a strong antipathy for a party, you will be a negative partisan. Most Brazilians, I'll show you actually sometimes less than half, but sometimes more than half, fall in the lower right quadrant as non-partisans. But you can have a negative partisan attitude, one that is powerfully felt and that impacts your political attitudes and even your voting choices without having a positive partisan identity. That's one of the key points that we're making in this book. And what we argue is that these negative partisans are the forgotten individuals in the study of mass partisanship. So we focus on both the positive and negative partisan attitude and suggest that you can't really understand Brazil's party system in the electorate without understanding both the positive and the negative sides of partisanship. So let me turn now to some of the data, some of the evidence. Obviously, I can't show you everything. I submitted five chapters for you to review. I'm going to focus first on the extent of both positive and negative partisanship. Many of you will have seen a figure like this somewhere because this is the data from Datafolha going back to 1989 when Datafolha first began asking a party ID question. And there are two things to note from this figure. The very solid black line is the aggregate level of all partisans, positive partisans in the electorate. The other solid line is the level of pechismo in the electorate. So the first thing to note is that between 40 and 50% of Brazilians affirmed a positive party ID for most of the period, and this has recently dropped to about 30%. The second is to note the dominance of the PT, of pechismo, in as a proportion of all positive partisans. At least half and sometimes two-thirds of all positive partisans historically have been pechistas. And only two other parties, the PMDB and the PSDB, have ever gotten more than 5% of the electorate in terms as partisans for any length of time. Sometimes one party will go a little bit higher, but then they drop away. So this is similar data. This is a different set of surveys. These are from the Estudo Eleitoral Brasileiro and the Estudo de Panel Brasileiro and a couple of other surveys, one from the Fundação Perseu Abramo and another from Datafolha. And the reason we separate these out is because these are the only surveys that we could find that included a question about negative partisanship. And what I want you to note from this particular slide is that when you add in negative partisans, the proportion of non-partisans in the electorate, the people who I've noted in the red box, drops to below 50%. And this completely inverts the perception that Brazil's electorate is mostly full of non-partisans. Note on this slide that for every year for which we have a measure, more than half of the electorate expresses some form of partisan attitude, positive and or negative. And in two cases, you can see that the proportion of partisans is actually about two-thirds, which is really quite high. And this, to me, raises significant questions about the conventional wisdom. It should at least raise questions about the conventional wisdom about the party system in Brazil's electorate. And what I show on this next slide is we take out the pechistas and antipechistas. And that is that partisanship, we're acknowledging, partisanship and partisan attitudes in Brazil is dominated by coxinhas e mortadelas, by pechistas and antipechistas. And so we focus most of the analysis in this book on these two categories, because looking at the smaller parties with 2 or 3% of the population really doesn't add much to the story. But what you can see here, even in 2014, about 40% of Brazil's electorate were either pro or anti-PT. This is pretty impressive still, given that it was 2014 and what was going on. And that year, the number of people who said they were non-partisans was 45%, was actually pretty high. And so the general point of this slide is that for the entire democratic period, the party system and the electorate has been mainly about the growth of the PT and the growth of opposition to the PT among voters. All the other parties are minor players in this opera. And for this reason, we focus on the PT and anti-PT story. So what I'm going to do now, after I've revealed the extent of partisanship, we spend a chapter in the book on the extent of partisanship, we turn to several questions. And the first is, well, what is the basis for this divide between pechistas and antipechistas? And our goal here is to show that the conventional wisdom, which we get from media accounts and from talking to people, that the conventional wisdom about the difference between pechistas and antipechistas is, if not a bit of wishful thinking on the part of pechistas, then mainly is also incorrect. And that is, there is no deep sociological divide in Brazil between pechistas and antipechistas. There is no social cleavage, clear, deep, marking a division between PT and anti-PT. And what you can see from this slide here is this is the proportion of pechismo crossed with income and education levels. What this does is it gives you the probability over time that people with different levels of income or education would be a pechista. And so on the left side, it's in minimum wages, a salario mínimo. What you can see there is a growth. The lowest line in 1990 is the poorest segment of the population. And the darkest line is the richest segment of the population. And these two lines cross in the 2000s. So that today, poorer Brazilians do have a slightly higher probability of being pechista than the richest segment of Brazilians. But it's not a difference of 40% and 4%. It's a difference of 17% versus 10 or 12%. That is the slightly higher difference. The same thing with education. Less educated Brazilians are now slightly more likely to be pechistas than the people at the top of the socioeconomic pyramid. But it's not a stark distinction. And what we show in this next slide is the same thing for antipechistas. We cross this with education and income. And what you see here is there is some tendency for higher socioeconomic status Brazilians to be antipechistas, but again, the differences are not huge. It is not like all Brazilians who have completed high school, or even say 60% of all Brazilians who have completed high school, have a 50% probability of being antipechistas, and a poor Brazilian has only a 5% probability of being an antipechista. That is, there's a little bit of a distinction in the socioeconomic column coalitions that support the PT and that support the anti-PT, anti-pechista. But this is not a clear, deep socioeconomic divide between poor and rich. That's the simple point we want to make. And we say we go on here and say, well, what is the basis then? One thing to note is that it's not about race. There is a little bit of a difference in the coalitions. Again, the people who are pechistas are slightly more likely to be racially diverse than the coalitions supporting the anti-PT. This is still education that what you can see, sorry. But the difference is not huge. This is, you can see here that the diamond, I'm sorry, the triangle, solid triangle on the right is anti-PT, and the solid circle is PT, and this is the probability of declaring yourself white. So you can see there is a tendency here. The pechista is somewhat less likely to declare themselves white. But then, you know, in the United States, over 90% of African Americans are Democrats. This is a clear racial cleavage in terms of political affiliation in the United States. And there's nothing like that in Brazil. There's nothing even close to that in Brazil. The next slide shows the same thing for ideological self-placement. And this really puzzles people when they see it, because you can see there in 2002, this is on the left, the PT, and on the right, the anti-PT. And they say, oh, that makes sense, right? Well, now look at 2014. The anti-pechista identifies slightly to the left of the pechista. It's not statistically different, but still, same thing in 2010, there's no difference. 2006, there's no difference. The point is, quite simply, there is no ideological difference between pechistas and anti-pechistas today. End of discussion. Doesn't matter how you measure it. Same thing if you want to ask about attitudes towards important public policies. This measures attitudes towards redistribution generally. In 1997, you see what you'd expect. Pechistas favor more redistribution, anti-pechistas favor less. But this difference has disappeared. In the last two surveys, there's no difference at all. Antipechistas appear to like redistribution just as much as pechistas since the late 2000s at least. Unfortunately, we don't have surveys for every year, but the point remains the same. There's no difference when you ask a general question about redistribution. The next slide we ask about lifestyle issues. Now this is about abortion.
the point we're trying to make with these questions is to say, look, antipachistas are not social conservatives. Attitudes towards abortion, no difference between pachistas and antipachistas. At least in the most recent survey, we had a couple of others that I didn't include on this slide just to make it easier to read. The point is there's no difference on abortion. Same thing when you ask about gay rights. There's no difference between pachistas and antipachistas when you ask about these or other social identity issues. They're not social conservatives. So I'll turn to our however, there's always a but here. And this is our key finding about the root of the divide between pachismo and antipachismo. This is a question about whether democracy is the best form of government. And we argue that the root of the divide between pachismo and antipachismo has to do with attitudes towards democracy. And I got to admit, it's not clear why. We don't have an explanation for why this is true, but antipachistas usually, over the course of the time series here, have the least positive response to the question that democracy is the best form of government, and pachistas have the strongest support for that notion. And this is perhaps due to the fact that pachistas like democracy because they see it as facilitating social and economic change, whereas antipachistas have a relatively negative attitude about democracy because they oppose such change. The divide essentially is about support for or opposition to social change, support for the socioeconomic status quo or opposition to the status quo, which to me, as I've been observing the PT for many years and now observing antipachismo, this makes a lot of sense intuitively, but we can't get more specific than that given the data that we have. So once we've explained the roots of the PT, anti-PT divide, the question for us is, of course, whether these differences matter. Do they have the effect you would predict? Does having a partisan or anti-partisan attitude explain your political attitudes and your voting behavior? A skeptic of partisanship in Brazil might say, no, we don't think it should. So we spend a lot of time and a lot of energy in this book saying that the actual answer is yes. And one way to show the importance of partisanship is through an examination of what's called motivated reasoning. This is what happens when we see partisans interpreting the world to fit preconceived notions about what is right and what is wrong. So if you take a look at this slide is evaluations of the economy by different groups, and just focus on the PT and anti-PT groups. This is 1997. And here, let's see, how is it, what is it doing? This is the extent to which they rate the economy as doing badly is the dependent variable. And here you can see in 1997, pachistas rate the economy as doing worse than other groups. But objectively in 1997, the economy was doing fairly well. Now this is one example. The next slide shows you in 2010, the same question was asked. Higher scores, again, indicate worse evaluations. Well, Lula was president in 2010, and the GDP grew 7% in 2010, but antipachistas consistently evaluate the economy as doing worse than every other group. This is an example of what we mean by motivated reasoning. When the PT is not in power, pachistas think the economy is terrible. And when the PT is in power, the pachistas think the economy is great, but antipachistas think the economy is terrible. And this is just one way in which people, it's evidence for how people filter information based on their partisan attitudes in Brazil. Here's another example. These are attitudes towards PT programs. Now remember, a previous slide I showed you that antipachistas have no problem with redistribution as a general principle. We showed that in a previous slide, but if you associate redistribution with PT policies, well, then it's bad. That's what antipachistas think. Now, this is the same effect we see in the United States. Last month, Obamacare was terrible. For Republicans, even though it was created by the Cato Institute and implemented by a Republican governor, all through Obama's terms, Republicans hated it. But
just last week, the new data have come out. Well, now that Republicans are president, even Republicans have a greater than 50% probability of liking Obamacare. It's the same thing going on in Brazil. If you associate a policy with a particular party, partisans are going to react differently to it. The next slide, I should explain this. How long have I been going? Do you keep it track? I have been?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to skip this. Well, the final chapter I'm going to discuss looks at the effect of partisanship on voting behavior. So here are the probabilities of voting for presidential candidates of your party or the other party for Petistas and PSDBistas. And the effect shows what you think should happen, that Petistas always vote for PT candidates at very high probabilities, and the PSDB identifiers also are very likely, somewhat less likely, to vote for PSDB candidates than PT candidates, but the effect is still quite strong. And for the PT, the effect is the same level that you'd see in the United States, a Democrat voting for Democratic candidates, or Republican voting for Republican candidates. The next slide, I show you what happens when you include anti-Petistas. If you follow along there, you'll see that there's a very low probability of voting for the PT, no surprise. And that one of the reasons we put it up this way is to show that anti-Petistas are not simply PSDBistas disfarçados, disguised. They're not substitutes for PSDBistas. They're not hidden Tucanos in a way. They're more likely to vote for the Tucano candidate, but not the same level as a PSDB, someone who has a positive PSDB partisan identity. And the next slide looks at down-ticket voting, that is voting for governor, senator, deputado federal, and deputado estadual. And this is 2002. I'll show you only 2 years. And what you see there is that this is for voting for PT candidates. So you can see fairly clearly there's the PT identifier is always more likely to vote for a PT candidate than a nonpartisan and or members of people who identify with other parties. I'm sorry, the top row is 2002, the bottom row is 2014. We didn't have Deputado Estadual in the 2014 survey. But the point is pretty clear that even for Deputado Federal, where we know many people forget to vote and or forget who they voted for, even with all the noise in the survey, we pick up a really strong effect. And with many states with hundreds of candidates, right? There's a really strong effect for Deputado Federal and even for Deputado Estadual in 2002. And here's the effect for PSDB voting for PSDB candidates. The diamond there is the PSDB identifiers. And you can see there's also an effect for people who say they're positive partisans for the PSDB, particularly in 2002 for every race, less so in 2014, where it's strangely, I thought, only for Deputado Federal, where you see an effect. And this is probably because there just aren't that many PSDB candidates for governor and senator. In another part of the book, we examine coalition voting and find similar effects. So I'm going to draw a conclusion here. Conventional wisdom about Brazil focuses on coxinhas e mortadelas. I think what we mainly focus on here is the notion that the conventional wisdom that pork, pageantry, and performance, that most voters are nonpartisan, is clearly incomplete, if not entirely incorrect. Parties matter a lot in voters' mind, whether as a positive attachment and affinity for an in-group or a dislike or even hatred for an out-group. Parties can matter as they can create these concepts of in-groups if they devote resources to cultivating a brand and if they have success when they're governing. I think the collapse of Petismo is largely due to the collapse of the economy and the perception that Dilma was incompetent in managing the economy. So the final point I'll make is that I think that our study has implications for the understanding of pork barreling of the impact of candidate evaluations of candidates' personal qualities on understanding voter attitudes and behavior in Brazil, because our findings suggest that for a large proportion of the electorate, these impressions of candidates and their performance are entirely endogenous to partisan attitudes. You cannot simply throw in candidate evaluations in a regression without controlling for partisanship and anti-partisan identities in the first place. So overall, we hope that our argument, that our argument and findings offer a useful reassessment of the extent and impact of partisan attitudes in Brazil since the return of competitive elections. I do hope that our book is not simply a history book in the near future, given what's happened in the last few years, but I still think it's a useful exploration of what's been going on. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Henrique, would you like to open the floor to questions on the Brazilian side?
No, Henrique, I don't think so. I think it's better to go to lunch in order to have have time to come back earlier. Okay?
Okay.
Great. Come back and participate again.
So we're going to break for lunch okay. Now. And then, okay.
Come back for discussion later. That's fine.
Okay. Great. All right, no questions on the Brazilian side. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
See you after lunch.
Yeah.
No, we're from you, but we're going
to. We'll have a session after. They're going to go to lunch.
They're going to go to lunch. We're going to sit here.
Oh.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
So we don't need a connection today.
Yes, we actually don't need a connection now. So we can actually, sure.
Okay. Take 5 minutes or something?